Thor wasn't around at the last, in the club, at the last sunspot. And therefore, he didn't realize that the last time I was asked to do something like this, it turned into three very large talks, plus about five shorter talks over 3 years. So I don't think he intended that. But first of all, let me say that I'm not a solar expert. I'm not a solar-terrestrial interaction expert, and my propagation knowledge is mostly from having been a ham for 45 years. So while I know people who do all of this stuff, and I've talked to them, I'm not an absolute expert. But what I'm going to try to do is talk about the solar physics and the atmospheric physics that leads to propagation, and then how that changes with the sunspot cycle and what we can expect at different parts of it, as far as band openings and things like that. This is what the sun has looked like for the last few years, and this is what it's going to look like in the next few years. The minima right now is going to be somewhere around 2019. And so we're moving right into that minimum, and I'll show you some plots of what type of things happens. Whoops. Let's get back. So let's talk about what causes this solar cycle, this sunspot cycle. First of all, the sun's a ball of gas. It doesn't have a solid surface anywhere. None of it is solid. In the center, you have hydrogen fusing into helium mostly. There's a few other things that happen. You get all the way up to iron with fusion in the sun. Beyond that, it takes a supernova. And by the way, astrophysicists think anything more than helium is a metal. So if I say metals, that means greater and greater than two. As you guys know from basic electronics, you have a coil and you put an AC current on that coil. It builds up, and a magnetic field builds up and collapses, builds up and collapses, and that creates an electric current or field in that coil, which fights the change. It tries to keep the change from happening. And that leads to phase delays and things like that. And if you have a really good coil, a really tight wound coil, and you're trying to run RF through it, it fights it so well that it chokes it off completely. We call that a choke. So basically, you have a situation where the electric current changes. The changing electric current is creating a magnetic field that's fighting that from happening. In the solar surface, where you have a big magnetic field, when that magnetic field tries to change, well, it turns out that there isn't a surface. There's just electrons and protons and actually nuclei out there, positive and negative charges. And when that magnetic field changes, it starts accelerating the electrons. They create a magnetic field that stops the magnetic field from changing. And because there's not much material there, these electrons can move very long distances without colliding with anything, so there's very low resistance, which means that when a magnetic field tries on the surface of the sun tries to change, the electric field immediately sets up a magnetic field that prevents that magnetic field from changing. We say in that case that the magnetic field is frozen in to the material on the sun. Now again, remember, none of this is solid. It's all gas and free electrons and things like that. And the other interesting thing is the sun, like all things that aren't solid and have a rotation, it rotates faster at the equator than the poles, which means that the magnetic field wraps up. The part that's frozen in at the equator is moving faster than the ones at the pole, and it starts winding up. And the easiest way to think of this is if you had a balloon, a very stretchy balloon, and you hold it at the top and bottom, and then somebody else rotates the middle around. And that gives you an idea, because it's the magnetic field is a surface. It's not solid. It isn't. But it isn't lines either. It's a continuous surface. Our one club member K3MT would say it's a vector potential field. He's right. And the result is that, as you know, you can make balloon animals by twisting up. Well, you can do the same thing here. You can really twist this up, and because it's non-material, it should just keep going. And you get a magnetic field that's wound very tight. The interesting thing about the magnetic field as it winds up is that, first of all, on the equator, you have it reversing like that, which means that if the magnetic potential and the stress, mechanical stress, get too high, it can recombine just by shortening. This can connect here, and it shortens up and it relieves the stress. So the magnetic equator of the sun is not actually very strongly wound. But above it and below it, in the temperate regions, if you will, of the sun, it gets wound very tight. And the result of that is that the stress, the mechanical stress, can equal the magnetic energy. And something's got to give. And you get what is known as active regions, which is where things start to try to straighten out from this very tightly wound situation. And again, because the sun is rotating faster at the equator and slower at the poles, the field here and here is greater than the field up here and down here. When the magnetic regions, when the active regions form, they have the same magnetic polarity as these areas that are wrapped around very tight, and the result is they repel. They both have, they're magnetic, they repel, just like putting two magnets together, they push each other apart. And so the magnetic regions, the active regions, get pushed up towards the polar regions where the field is less strong, and so now they're really strong compared to the stuff around them, and things start to break down. So when the solar cycle begins and things start to wrap up, the first place you see active regions is at the high latitudes. Then as more and more active regions move up there, the magnetic field increases, and they don't go quite as far and quite as far and quite as far, and they move toward back towards the pole. So one of the characteristics of the solar cycle is that the active regions on the sun start at the higher latitudes and move towards the equator over time. So, just recapping, when the magnetic stress exceeds the magnetic field strength, something has to give. And what can give is things in the third dimension. It can't go in the second direction. It's two dimensions on the magnetic surface because it's frozen into the material. But what it can do is it's denser below, not so dense above, can't go to either side, so it goes into the third dimension like that. And the sheets of the magnetic field wrinkle, and they come up like that. The other, when this happens, we're looking at it like that. And on the edge of the wrinkled surface, you're looking down the magnetic field. And it's also going into the sun a little bit. That region can create little sort of tubular areas that have high pressure. And that high pressure does two things. First of all, you're looking down the field lines. All the materials moving along the field lines, that's not chaotic. That's a little more organized. That immediately is a lower temperature. Secondly, it cuts off warm material coming up from the center of the sun, and so these areas become lower temperature. And those lower temperature areas are not as bright as the bright areas around it, so they appear dark. And it's what we call sunspots. So we see that cooler material as sunspots. That's electrons essentially following wrinkle. And when you look down, oops, when you look down the lines, you see sunspots. And these things are magnetic. I mean, you know, it's like this would be a north pole and this would be a south pole. So they're opposite fields. And there's material that's following it, spiraling around out of one and into the other. And that's what we see, that all of the magnetic field lines that were magnetic field surfaces that we're looking at are sheets, they're being traced out by material. And material, while the magnetic field is all continuous and can interact with itself and the vectors change and it sort of mushes together, the material can't. And material has to abide by physics too. So if they're positively charged, they'll repel each other and they'll line up in what looks like lines and things like that. But really, they're just tracing out a sheet. So, active areas start near the equator where the stress is greater. They repel and move towards the poles. And sunspots are a diagnostic of the recombination relaxation. They are not the cause of it. They're a diagnostic of what's going on. And the cycle repeats roughly every 11 years, but it also flips the magnetic sign. What used to be north is now south pole, magnetic pole. So it's really a 22-year cycle. There's all sorts of arguments going on whether you can treat it as a two 11-year cycles or whether it has to be treated as one 22-year cycle. I think the 22-year cycle is winning at the moment. All right. Let's take a look at some of this, if I can do this without screwing things up too badly. NASA put up a satellite called the Solar Dynamic Observatory, and this is 7 years of data. This is every frame is one day. So it goes through a month and a little over a second. What you should see here, first of all, is the equator on both of these. This is the solar atmosphere. It shows the active regions. This shows sunspots. And this is the solar activity going up here. The first thing you should notice is that there's an empty spot at the equator. Secondly, that as we go up here, the larger sunspots and more sunspots are in the northern hemisphere. As we come over the first peak, you start seeing the larger sunspots and more sunspots in the southern hemisphere, which means that the northern hemisphere and the southern hemisphere of the sun are not in perfect synchronization. And that's actually a relief, because they should both be doing about the same thing, but if they were doing it exactly the same way, then you'd have to say, why? What's syncing them up? And in fact, they're not. They're close, but they're not the same. So now the southern hemisphere is starting to peak, along with some contribution from the northern hemisphere, and we're getting the second peak. And in this particular case, the second peak was higher than the first. I'll show you later that that's not unusual, despite what the internet says. And as you can see, we're now in 2014. We're coming back down. Things are moving closer together. Over here, it's a little, you can still see where the equator is, but it's getting a little harder as the sunspots move toward, the active regions move towards the equator. Up here, you're really having trouble deciding where the equator is. And we're starting to come down in the solar active area, and so we're getting less and less active regions. All right, I want to point out something here. I don't know how well you guys can see that, but one of the things to notice is it's a faster rise and a slower decay. That is typical, very typical of sunspot. The sunspot cycle, it always rises fast and decays slow. And what it does in the middle here, different every time. Oops. That's not what I wanted to do. No, it is what I have to do. Let's go back to where we were. Okay. So, magnetic field can reorganize in the intersection of fields. It smooshes together down here at the bottom. And since it isn't solid, they can just sort of meld, and the vectors change around, and things find something nearby that moves them over. And what happens is the sheet tries to remove the warp and enter a lower energy state. This is high energy state. Low energy state is that. So if you can pinch this off at the bottom and sort of detach this top thing, you shorten the whole thing, you release a lot of stress, and you get a much lower flat sheet. The top part, this round part up the top, is a flux tube, what's called a flux tube, and it can actually detach and sit up above, and it'll be traced out eventually by the particles and everything starting to react to it. The flux tube is not a long-term stable situation. It's got material, it's a balance between the material and the magnetic field, where each one is helping support the other, and you eventually run out of gas and the flux tube collapses. And again, in what you're going to see in the future, the charged particles are tracing out the flux tubes. The flux tubes are actually magnetic fields, and the combination of material and magnetic flux are keeping them going. And same thing with the prominences and acceleration shocks. And that's another thing you're going to see. When this pinches off down the bottom, the magnetic fields down the bottom, as that flux tube starts to separate, go like this. That's an accelerator. That's just like a particle accelerator on Earth. And so all the material is shot out sideways at high speed, and it creates a shock. And you can see that. There's a line of hot material that gets pushed out, or as the shock moves through the material, And that's that acceleration coming out the side. So a lot of the material that gets ejected from the sun doesn't come straight out of the sun at us, or some of it does. But a lot of it comes out sideways because of this acceleration when the recombination occurs and relaxes our flux. That's a flux tube. That's not a very organized one, but it is one. There's a better one, and you can really see that. So these things are, nowadays we get to see these things. Now above that region is the corona, and it's very hot. It's a million degrees or so, several million degrees in some parts. It doesn't have much mass, so there's not a lot of heat there. However, it does have a high temperature. Because of everything's moving very fast, because of the thermal temperature, it has a pressure. The material that comes up from below, like the accelerated stuff out the side or stuff blown out the top, it runs into the corona. So it has to have enough energy to actually push the corona up with it. And we tend to call that coronal mass ejection, because that's where it comes from, the corona, even though it's energized from underneath. That's the corona. Everything brown on here is the corona. You see sort of atmosphere, high atmosphere on the sun. And you can just imagine that as being sort of a little cap over the sun, and it's keeping things from coming out. And that's true of the solar wind, too. We'll get to that. So when you go from a higher or lower energy, you release a higher energy state to a lower energy state, release a lot of energy. Question is how much? If you don't have much, then you get a little reaction. You get a flux tube up there. The flux tube collapses and everything falls back into the sun. It doesn't get through the corona. You have a little more energy. The energy under the flux tube can launch the flux tube up. And you can get a CME if you have enough energy. Or you can get a small flare and no actual launch of material. If you have a lot of energy, then you get a major event. You get a solar flare, and you get a material launch and a coronal mass ejection. That's the mass ejection, by the way, can go in any direction. That's a solar flare. Notice it's on the edge of the sun. Why? Because stuff is coming. Some of the stuff is coming out sideways. This is a coronal mass ejection from LASCO. There's the material coming out, and it's on its way. I think this one actually gave us a glancing blow. All right, now we get to look at some fun stuff. This is a repeated look at a single area of the sun. There's your shock waves going out, and here's your flux tube. Now notice there's material coming straight out, so it's blown things out. You've got those shock waves on the side, and then you have the flux tube forming. And actually the flux tube's there, it's just the material is starting to recover from the stuff being thrown out, the material being thrown out. There you go, there's the sideways. And there's the material. You can see that material really got blown out on that one. This, by the way, what you're looking at is 2 days worth of observations, so it's sped up quite a bit. And again, you see it. So here comes the flux tube, man.
So what is the light intensity on this?
Okay, there's a couple of things. First of all, it's the UV. It's extreme UV. What you're looking at is extreme ultraviolet radiation due to the energetics. I mean, it's very high energy.
So is the brightness proportional to the amount of UV light?
Yes. Yeah. It's all intensity. So yeah. So you get an idea. This is not an academic. Somebody thinks this might be happening. This is actually going on. Just have to work our way through. That's why I left the blue screen. Okay, so what happens when this stuff reaches the Earth? That's what we're really interested in. With the normal sun, the extreme ultraviolet ionizes atomic oxygen and creates what's known as the F layer. This is the main refractive layer. It's actually refraction. A lot of people call it reflection because the radio signals go up and bounce down, but it's actually, they actually curve and come back down. The soft X-rays and far UV, which can go down further through the atmosphere, they ionize O2, which is the molecule, not atomic hydrogen, and they create the E layer. And then there's a thing called sporadic E, and nobody knows what causes it. And that's an interesting propagation mode, but it's not really well understood. And then the Lyman alpha, which is the strongest line of hydrogen, which it sums mostly hydrogen, plus X-rays ionize NO, N2, O2, and that creates the D layer. And the D layer is an absorption layer. And that's what prevents us, from particularly low bands, from going anywhere. Here's a diagram. The F layer can actually split into two in the daytime. The E layer is there and the D layer is there. But remember, all this stuff is electromagnetic. It's waves, it's light, although UV and X-ray and things like that. It doesn't get affected by the Earth's magnetic field. So it doesn't matter. It just comes right through and it ionizes the various levels of the ionosphere. At night, the E layer and D layer disappear, and the F layer combines into one layer. So the D layer, remember I said, was absorption. It means the absorption disappears. D layer absorption disappears at night. And that has something to do with the way our bands work. Now, particles from a CME coming in has to deal with, and the solar wind, has to deal with the Earth's magnetic field. And they come in and they try to, they basically follow the Earth's magnetic field and come into the poles. And I hate this thing right here, that's wrong. Magnetic lines or magnetic fields don't break. That's impossible. Maxwell's equation says that doesn't happen. And what happens is the vectors start to get all connected up and they come apart in a different way than they went together. Well, Zymergy, once you've let the worms out of the can, you can't get the worms back into the can without using a larger can. Whether it's solar wind or a CME, one of the important things is that the incoming solar particles also have a magnetic field attached. If the magnetic field attached, if the component along the poles of the Earth is in the same direction as the Earth's magnetic field, they repel. And it's harder for the particles to come in. If they're the other way around, opposite, then they're not repelled. And they have a lot easier time getting in. So one of the important things is which way is the magnetic field of the solar wind or the CME oriented with respect to Earth's magnetic field. Now when we have a high solar activity, like we sort of had back in 2013 and 14, you get more charged particles reaching the F layer, and that makes it denser and reflects higher frequencies. Some enhancement of the D layer, which means you get increased absorption during the day, which means the lower frequencies are kind of useless in the daytime. And DX is enhanced at the higher frequencies and at night. Night because you don't have the D layer. You also get more aurora. You get more energetic particles with Earth's magnetic field, so the Earth's magnetic field gets tangled up, and that causes geomagnetic disturbances. The geomagnetic disturbance in the ionosphere sort of breaks up the ionosphere a little bit. It's like trying to shave in a mirror ball. So it's not as good. And if you have a flare, a flare will emit everything from gamma rays to radio. They're electromagnetic. They're running at the speed of light. It means you don't get a warning. It doesn't matter where you have a spacecraft, but the time the spacecraft radios back that there's a solar flare, it's gotten to. And it's not affected by Earth's magnetic field. Reconnections to the magnetic field can open the ionosphere. All sorts of things happen. The bottom line is, due to the fact that the F layer can actually sort of get blown away and the D layer can be enhanced, propagation disappears. 25 years ago on field day at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, we had a solar flare and the bands went dead. It was like your radio died. The only reason we knew nothing had broken was because there was, where we were at field day, we were on top of a mountain, there were a couple of other field day groups on other mountains, and we were able to talk to them and say, hey, did you guys lose signals? And they go, yeah, did our, you know, something wrong? And we could figure out that it's a solar flare. Solar flares last about an hour, and then for the effects of the solar flare last about an hour, and then they're over. Coronal mass ejection takes 2 or 3 days to reach Earth. They're now tracked by spacecraft, so you get a warning. They interact with Earth's magnetic, everything goes the same way. You get geomagnetic storms. And the good news is that you get enhanced propagation after everything dies down, because there's thicker, denser ionosphere layers. So things actually can get good at the end. This is a 2012 event. That's the coronal mass ejection. This is Earth. And there's the coronal mass ejection. These water sprinkler type things are solar wind out of coronal holes. We'll get to that. So you can see over here, here comes the... Anyway, you get warning. It takes a while. Okay, when you have low solar activity, like we're coming into, you have a lower number of coronal mass ejections, you have much lower number of flares. So you don't get enhancement that way, and you don't get the F layer enhancement or the D layer. But coronal holes become a major effect. In fact, coronal holes were postulated because there were these geomagnetic disturbances when nothing was going on in the sun, and what was going on. And they were finally seen by spacecraft above the atmosphere, if you look in the extreme UV. This is last week. The coronal hole. Corona's all around here and the holes here. Now, say corona's holding stuff in, it keeps the solar wind velocity down by the time it fights its way out of the corona. When you get a hole, the solar wind comes right out at a much higher speed. And so that can come into the Earth and create a geomagnetic disturbance, enhancement of the various ionosphere layers, and whatever. So let's take a look at the ham bands and what this means. Below 10 megahertz, absorption, almost always something below 10 megahertz will be refracted in the F layer and come back to Earth. The problem is they get absorbed by the D layer. So in the daytime, 80 and 40 meters is absorbed. If you have a D layer of any thickness. Above 10 megahertz, the major influence of refraction. Above 10 megahertz, it goes through the D layer without a whole lot of absorption. And then the question is whether the F layer can refract it back to Earth or not. So that's where your maximum usable frequency comes in. If it's below the maximum, if your signal is below the maximum usable frequency, then it's going to be refracted back down and you can use that band. Otherwise, it just goes straight through and you can use it to talk to a satellite. So 20 through 10 meters is open during the daytime when it's open. 20 and 17 meters is sometimes open at night at a cycle peak because the F layer is thick enough. And there's no D layer. And 10 megahertz is an interesting frequency. It's always open. Maybe. So when we have low solar propagate activity, which is what we have coming up, and actually we're sorting it now, the higher frequencies are less likely refracted back to Earth, and 15 to 10 meters only opens in the day, if it opens at all. This afternoon, it sounded like 20 meters. The E layer is weaker, so you don't get the lower skip on the higher frequencies that you sometimes get. And the D layer has lower absorption, so 8 through 30 meters gets further because it can get through the D layer and off the F layer. And they can open during the day. 40 meters will open during the day, almost certainly, at minima, solar minima. So what do we look for if you want to know what is going on and whether you have something likely to be, whether you're likely to use a particular band or something? Well, the first thing is sunspot number. But problem with sunspot number, it's highly variable for the same solar activity. We've had about the same solar activity for the last 6 months. The sunspot number has gone from 0 to 90, and propagation has been pretty much the same. However, it is the input for propagation programs, so, but you're better off using a smooth number rather than individual day numbers. The solar flux index, on the other hand, which is a radio measurement of the flux off of the sun, is more reliable than sunspot number. And the lowest number that you can have with the solar flux is around 65. They used to say 67, but we keep that last commitment. And then the third thing is K index. The K index is a measure of the geomagnetic disturbance. And higher is worse, as far as it causes the ionosphere to be non-nicely reflecting. And there are actually different K indices for different latitudes, and you can sometimes see propagation being talked about in terms of what the path is, whether it's a high latitude path or a low latitude path or equatorial path or whatever. But for most things, you want to use the planet, what is known as the planetary K index, which covers the entire, or sort of averages over most of the Earth. So other things to look for. Number and orientation of active regions. Are they facing us or are they complex or simple? Don't worry about complex or simple. If you read this stuff, they'll say, region 9336 is showing complex. Or they may call it alpha, beta, and delta. Alpha, beta, delta? I don't know what happened to Charlie. And alpha is a very simple unit or area region, and delta is a very complex region. Is there a coronal hole, and is it pointed at us? That's another thing, and when is it likely to impact us? And finally, the Z component, that is the polar facing component of the Earth, of the solar wind's magnetic field. If it's if it's positive, it's aligned with the Earth field, it gets where things get repelled. If it's negative, then it's anti, and it can make it through easier. I go to here. This is the best, I think one of the best places to start. It's solarham.com or solarham.net. Either one of them works. This is done by V3EN, and he collects data from all over. A lot of what you see on this comes from NASA, from NOAA, from the Canadian Space Weather Bureau, from the Australians for the Southern Hemisphere. He just collects it all together. There's a dashboard over here, which is done, actually, he's loaded it from N0NPH, I think it is, can't quite read it. It has the solar flux index, the sunspot number, and the K index in an easy to see fashion. It also has the Boulder maximum usable frequency, which is sort of good for North America, maybe not for the rest of the world. You also have things like what's the 3-day geomagnetic forecast. This was March 2nd, this year, you know, a couple of days ago. It was, K index was 5 on the 2nd, expected to be 4 on the 3rd, and 3 on the 4th. So you get an idea of what it. This is the K index, I'll show that a little bit. And down here is the ACE solar wind magnetic field direction. This up here, this red trace up here, which some of you might not be able to see, is the ACE magnetic field Z component of the solar wind. When it's negative, like it is in this area here, you're more likely to have a geomagnetic disturbance if there's material coming in, like a coronal hole or a CME or something like that. Over here, at the end here, it's positive. That's less likely to have an interaction. This is a history of the K index over the last few days. This was done on March 2nd, almost March 3rd, UT. And you can see that on March 2nd, the K index was greater than 4, red, greater than 4, geomagnetic disturbance. I might add, during sunspot minimum, a geomagnetic disturbance isn't necessarily all bad. It may not be, it may mess up the ionosphere being a nice smooth reflector, but on the other hand, it will reflect, which it may not do without having some sort of enhancement. So sometimes you can actually get through on a frequency that you don't expect, even if the K index is high. And this is a historical sunspot cycle. They just changed the way they define it. It's an algorithm, basically how much of the sun is covered by a sunspot. And they changed the algorithm to make the solar flux and the sunspot number a little closer for some other reasons. But what I want to point out here, we're down over here. This one was last sunspot cycle, which was, according to the internet, totally strange because the second peak was higher than the first. Well, that one was higher. That one's higher in the second peak. That one's higher in the second peak. That one's higher in the second peak. That's not unusual. Notice that even though we're low, there are other places that have been equally low. So even the fact that we have a low cycle is not particularly unusual. The only thing unusual on this whole thing is this one right here. That's 1959. That's the highest one on record. That one, I understand, I wasn't a ham back then, but I understand it was something else. 6 meters was open a lot. 10 meters was open all the time. Truly amazing. Okay, this is the present. This is the last cycle, higher. Again, the second peak was higher than the first peak. Went down, this was our long period of low in here. Then we came up and we didn't go very high, and it came back down. And we're now heading towards minimum. When? Who knows? Last cycle, particularly the minimum, everybody was fretting what was going to happen, when was it going to start, and everything else. Dr. Keith Strong at GSFC said the physics, solar physics community is grade for predicting cycle 24, which is the one we're in now, is F. Nobody was right. They totally blew it. And even read on the internet now, you'll see people sitting here going, well, what's so hard? You just fit Fourier transform to the series of sunspot cycle and it'll tell you what the next one is. If you have an infinite number of parameters you can fit, you can always fit something, but it's not going to be very good predicting. So, we are nearing the end of cycle 24. Minimum right now is, they think, is going to be around 2019. We don't know when it's going to happen. We don't have any idea how long that minimum is going to last. We don't know when cycle 25 is going to start. And we don't know how strong cycle 25 is going to be. Does that make it clear? Okay, let's recap HF propagation. Solar activity is high, 15 through 6 meters open in the daytime, sometimes at night on 15. 20 and 17 are open 24 hours, 30 meters is both always open, and 80, 60, and 40 meters are only open at night. And this is pretty much what we've been having in the last few years. We're getting out of it. At this, when the solar activity is low, you switch 15 and 10 meters opens during the day, if then. 20 and 17 are open at the day and sometimes at night, but mostly just during the day. 30 meters is always open, and 80, 60, and 40 meters can be open 24 hours. So last sunspot, I remember last sunspot minimum, for example, on field day, 40 meters was the band. It was open 24 hours. Had lots and lots of stations on it. So that's sort of the situation. Hope I gave you a little idea why it happens, as well as what happens. Thanks.